Leah here from Leah4sci.com, and in this video, I will show you how to analyze the alkyl chain when determining between SN1, SN2, E1, and E2 reactions. The first thing to analyze when determining between substitution and elimination reactions is the degree of substitution of the carbon holding the leaving group, and there are five types of carbons that you will see. There's the methyl carbon, primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary. A methyl carbon occurs when you have a methyl group, which is CH3, and that's bound to a leaving group, which I will show as LG in my videos. For the rest of the carbons, to determine their substitution, simply count the number of carbons attached to them. So to do a quick review, on this molecule here, we'll start by identifying primary carbons. A primary carbon just has one other carbon attached to it. That means every terminal carbon is going to be primary because they're only attached to one other carbon. If you have a leaving group attached to the primary carbon, that is considered a primary leaving group. A secondary carbon is a carbon that has two other groups attached to it. For example, this carbon here is attached to one carbon on the left and one carbon on the right. So is this one, these two, this one. If we place a leaving group on a secondary carbon, this is considered a secondary leaving group. A tertiary carbon is a carbon that is attached to three other carbons, and in this molecule we have two tertiary carbons. If I place a leaving group on the tertiary carbon, it's considered a tertiary leaving group. A quaternary carbon is a carbon that has four other carbons attached to it. According to the octet rule, a carbon can only have 8 valence electrons and therefore 4 bonds, so a quaternary carbon cannot hold a leaving group. However, you will see it participating in reactions if there's a potential for a methyl shift or carbocation rearrangement. So how does this apply to reactions? I like to start my analysis of the one-type reactions, and this refers to SN1 and E1, which both undergo a carbocation intermediate. In order to analyze the carbocation intermediate, we have to talk about the stability. A carbocation is a carbon that has only three groups attached to it. That leaves it deficient in its valence shell with a formal charge of +1. While a carbocation in general is slow to form, you have different levels of stability which will directly impact the rate of reaction. You can refer to my carbocation video for a detailed analysis of its stability, but as a quick review, a methyl carbocation is simply a carbon bound to three hydrogens with a positive charge. This is very unstable and will not form. The next one you have is a primary carbocation, and this is a terminal carbon that has a positive charge. This is also unstable and once again will not form. A secondary carbocation is a secondary carbon with a positive charge. This one is considered moderately stable and will form. And finally, a tertiary carbocation is a carbocation with three R groups attached. This is the most stable of your standard carbocations and therefore the quickest to form. But don't forget your pi systems, including your allylic and benzylic carbocations. If you have a molecule that has a positive charge with a double bond next to it, the pi bond can resonate towards the positive charge, allowing the carbons to share that burden of charge and therefore making it more stable. An allylic carbocation is going to be more stable than a tertiary carbocation, and this can occur as a primary allylic. You can have a secondary allylic carbocation. You can even have a tertiary allylic carbocation. In addition to gaining stability from the carbon surrounding that positive charge, you have the added stability of the resonance allowing multiple carbons to share that burden of charge. And finally, you have your benzylic carbocations, which are even more stable than the allylic carbocations, given that the positive charge can resonate into the ring, allowing multiple atoms to share that burden of charge. Here we have a primary benzylic carbocation. Here we have a secondary, and here we have a tertiary benzylic carbocation. Now remember, primary benzylic, even though it's primary, is still a lot more stable than a regular tertiary carbocation because we're not only looking at the primary position, but also the fact that the positive charge can go into the ring. Once you identify that your molecule has the ability to support a positive charge, you want to consider the E1 and the SN1 reaction as follows. If we have an allylic or benzylic system, you know it's going to have a stable carbocation. If we have a tertiary leaving group, that'll be stable too. And you want to think of the one-type reactions. It gets a little tricky with a secondary carbocation, given that it's somewhat slow to form and you may have competing reactions between the one type, meaning SN1 E1, and the two type, meaning SN2 and E2. If you see a primary or a methyl leaving group, you can rule out your SN1 and E1, given that these will not form stable carbocations and therefore the reaction will not occur. Now let's analyze the two type reactions, specifically SN2 and E2. Unlike SN1 and E1, we can't classify the two together because the way they react or the molecules that they prefer to attack can be different. An SN2 reaction involves a nucleophile coming in to attack the carbon specifically holding the leaving group. So we're looking for a minimally substituted leaving group. Therefore, for an SN2 reaction, your ideal molecule is going to have a leaving group in the methyl position or in the primary position. However, you can still have a reaction at the secondary position. But it's not only the leaving group that you want to focus on, you also want to see what's going on next to this molecule. Let's compare these two molecules. They both have a leaving group on a secondary carbon. However, the molecule on the left is rather small with minimal groups on the side, and that means a nucleophile will have an easier time getting in. However, the molecule on the right is considered very bulky and therefore sterically hindered. If we compare the ability of the nucleophile to attack the molecule on the left compared to attacking the molecule on the right, the bulkiness of the molecule on the right will slow down that SN2 reaction. In fact, depending on the situation, the molecule on the right might go for a one-type reaction, where the molecule on the left will go for a two-type reaction. When dealing with E2, you have to analyze the molecule in a slightly different way. E2 is beta elimination, so we have to analyze not only the position of the leaving group, but also the availability of beta hydrogens. This molecule has a leaving group on a tertiary carbon, and we'll call that the alpha carbon. However, the carbons next to it are considered the beta carbons, and these will provide the hydrogens that can be removed in the elimination reaction. Therefore, despite the fact that the leaving group is tertiary, which implies that we can have a carbocation, the fact is we have plenty of beta hydrogens available, and so given proper conditions, we can have an E2 reaction. That means we can have primary, secondary, or tertiary leaving groups experiencing an E2 reaction. However, an E2 reaction cannot take place when you have a methyl attached to a leaving group, and that's because even though the leaving group is on what we'll call the alpha carbon, there is no beta carbon present to provide a beta hydrogen for elimination. This can also happen with a larger molecule, such as what we see here. The carbon holding the leaving group is the alpha carbon. However, the beta carbon is quaternary and therefore does not have a hydrogen that can be removed for the elimination reaction. Be sure to join me in the next video where I show you how to analyze the similarities and differences between strong and weak nucleophiles and strong and weak bases for substitution and elimination reactions. Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit Leah4sci.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O secrets. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two. If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/Leah4sci. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.